glad that you're here with us. If you're here on Facebook Live or if you're here in person, we just ask that you join us as we worship our Christ today. I'm going to introduce this next song. It's a fairly new one, so even if you might not have even heard it on the radio. A few weeks ago, my stepfather passed away kind of suddenly. We knew he was sick, but it happened in literally 3 weeks from the day that we found out he was sick. And I'm going to get it kind of a little emotional, but he thought that I was the best singer in the world. And he'd asked my mom if I would sing at his service. And so I did, by the grace of God. But during that time, I was really in a rough shape because I just didn't know if I could do it. And so I heard this song, and it brought me to a really special place, and I think it will make sense for all of you, but I just want to share what some of the words are. In the chorus it says, "He makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is that I know that he can do the same as he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus." And I just think about my own life and my stepdad's life and all of our lives. We're all broken people. But Jesus comes in and he says, "Not with me. You're not broken anymore. Not with me." So even though this is a peppy song, I'm going to need you to pray for me because I've not been able to make it through without getting teary-eyed. But it is just a really good song with a really great message. And if you're ever at a point where you're feeling so broken and you're weary from the state that you're in, this is a great song to listen to because it's about Jesus and how he can come in and he can save you.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all it's stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave.
He makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up.
Romans 5:5 says, "And this hope will not lead to disappointment. For we know how dearly God loves us, because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love." When we place our hope in Christ, even through difficult times, it influences us. I just pray right now, I ask right now for all of us to just say a prayer for whatever is going on in your life. I do ask that we pray for our schools, our teachers, all of the people that are on the front line right now working during this difficult time. God, just let's just pray for God's protection, and then I'll close this up in prayer in just a few moments. We do. We just come to you right now and we ask for your hope to fill us. We've been going through this difficult time for such a long time, but I know it's nothing in comparison to what the Israelites went through, and you saw them through to the end. So God, I just pray that your Holy Spirit would pour down into us, give us the strength and the peace and the hope to endure. God, just give us your support, God. Give us your protection. And help us to trust in you no matter what. It's in your holy name I pray. Amen.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Yeah. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or on my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Stand in your presence, to my knees will I fall, will I sing hallelujah, will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine, yeah, I can I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Amen. 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 It's time to go home, isn't it? Jeez. Oh. Thank you. Thank you. I had no idea what music they were going to play. And I'm just going to tell you, y'all just blew it out of the park. Oh. Good morning. Thank you, Mike. Good morning. Before I get started, I do want to make a few announcements. Let me tell you, Donna and Steve are getting better. They will be tested tomorrow again, and if they are negative, they'll be back to work. And of course, if not, you know what that means. We are asking for distancing and masks. It's optional. Hand washing, y'all just do your part. You know how important this is. You know that it is very serious. If you have not been vaccinated, please consider being vaccinated. I have a dear friend in Springville, not vaccinated, in the hospital twice, but thank God on this side of the pearly gates now. So it's dreadful. It's dreadful. Family Day has been postponed. There's threats of thunderstorms today, so it will be rescheduled, so just watch for that. And so, and when y'all leave, if you will not linger, because I have a feeling I'm going to be a little long, you know, but not linger and go out the door and out the exit, please, so that the next service can come in and we don't have as many people back and forth. So anyway, I should have known that Steve was going to ask me to preach today, because I've had this passage of Luke, this one verse in Luke, on my heart this whole month, and I've been pondering that, and obviously that's what we're going to do. So one verse, but pray with me, please. Lord God, you have called me to such a time as this. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts together be acceptable in your sight. Lord, you are our strength, our rock, our hope, and our Redeemer. Amen. I get a subscription from it's called the Monastic Way, and from Joan Chittister, who is a Catholic nun. And what she does is she takes a theme for the year. Last year we talked about, each month was about a different person in Scripture. This year she is taking passages with hard meanings and expounding on them over the course of the month. Well, of course, this month comes from the passage today from Luke 14:34, but it comes from the passage on the cost of being a disciple. the cost of discipleship. And you know this passage. It talks, whoa. Sorry, Lord. I will hold you. Talks about being hating your mother and your father and your husband and your wife, your child, your brothers, your sisters. It talks about carrying your own cross. It talks about not starting a building without counting the cost beforehand. I don't know of an architect that would start a building without knowing how much it's going to cost, only to get halfway through and say, oops, I don't have enough money. Or a king who doesn't go out into battle without looking at his opponent and seeing what his opponent's army looks like, and can he maybe defeat him? But then he comes to our passage today from Luke 14:34, and you will see this one slide. Salt is good, but if it loses its taste, how can it be restored? Now, I have ruminated on this all month. For the past 2 weeks, I have thought about this passage. You know what ruminate means? I think of a cow in her cud, you know? When you feed cows, you feed them at the trough, and they gulp up all that food real quick, and it goes into their stomach, and then they take off and they go to another place, a place of calm and a place of quiet, and then they pull that back up, and they chew, and they chew, and they chew. It's a slow and deliberate process. Now, I always thought that a cow had two stomachs, but guess what? There's four parts in a cow's stomach, but one stomach. Okay, now you've had your lesson in Animal Husbandry 101. But I've thought about this passage, and I've ruminated on this passage, and I really thought, salt, the purpose of salt is really for flavoring and preserving, isn't it? How can you make it more salty? How can it lose its taste? Have you ever had salt that went bad? I haven't. Have you? Have you had salt that's gone bad? I haven't. So I'm thinking, that's a literal thinking. Literal. Jesus wasn't using literal thinking when he was talking in this passage. And let me tell you something, we can't afford to read the scriptures literally, or we will miss the point altogether. We need to know the context. We need to know who's talking, to whom, where, what country, who's the government, who's in charge, what's going on in the time. Because their time and our time may be very, very different. And so reading scripture literally is not good. But you know, in this passage, Jesus was referring in the salt to us. He's telling us we are salt. Now, if I was to say Judy is salt and put Judy in that passage, listen to this. Judy is good, but if she loses her purpose, now isn't that what salt, the purpose of salt is for flavoring and preserving? But if she loses her purpose, how can she become good again? Now, look on this screen. We're going to do this together. And what we're going to do is we're going to put our name. You will put your name in the blank. We're going to read it all together. And that first blank, when we say it, it's going to sound just like a big mishmash. But we're going to read this together. And I'll read it to you first. Judy is good, but if I lose my purpose, how can I become good again? All right, read that with me now and say your own name. Judy is good, but if I lose my purpose, how can I become good again? Read it again. Now, if you know it, it's really easy, but if you know it, I want you to close your eyes. I would ask you to close your eyes and listen around you as we repeat this again. Go. Judy is good, but if I lose my purpose, how can I become good again? You know, Jesus told us that if salt is no good, it's not even good for the ground or the manure pile. You just toss it out. But one thing he didn't say, how do you make it good? How do you make it good again? How can we become good if we have lost our purpose? How can we? Jesus doesn't give us that in the passage. So tell me, how can we become good again if we lose our purpose? Talk to me. Unorthodox here, but talk to me. Pray. How else can we become good? Scripture, doing better. Serving. Repenting. Whoa, do you hear? There is a way. There is a way to become restored. There is a way. How many of you dream? And I don't mean nighttime dreaming, because I nighttime dream and I don't remember half of those things. But I mean dreaming, you know, dreaming about what's going to happen tomorrow, or dreaming what's going to happen next week, or dreaming what's going to happen in the next year, 2, 10, 15, 20. It's also called a vision. It's also a destination for your purpose. With no vision, people perish. That sounds familiar, doesn't it? Proverbs 29:18. This vision comes from God. And if we don't get our vision from God, do you know where our vision comes from? The world, the culture. And we end up becoming like the culture. So what in the world do dreams and vision all have to do with the purpose and the salt from Luke? You see, I believe that God has placed a piece of God's self inside each and every one of us. Inside of me, inside of you, inside of your neighbor, even the neighbor you don't like, the neighbors all in Gardendale, all the people in Alabama, all the people North America, South America, Asia, Europe, the world. I believe God has placed a piece of God's self in every single person. How do we live our purpose? We all have a different personality. We've all come from different families. We've even come from different places in the United States. I was born in South Dakota. And when we grew up, we were all taught different things. And when we start into life, we start in the same direction with the same purpose. But life happens. We veer off, and our dreams get lopsided. And when that happens, culture takes hold, and we become like the world. And then I, you, us, we become very self-sufficient. We become very self-righteous sometimes, and we become very self-centered. Let me share an example. When I was growing up, I didn't know what I wanted to be when I grew up. And my cousin was a nurse, and so I decided I wanted to be a nurse. And so she went to the 2-year program, I went to the 4-year program. I wanted to get the degree. My daddy said, you have to have a degree. So I got the BSN, got a degree in nursing. And then I went into the job with my opinionated personality. If you know me, you know I have a very opinionated personality. But you know what? Lo and behold, guess what? There were other people there with opinionated personalities. And back then, it was mostly women working, and lousy, you talk about a mess. I would much rather work with a room full of men than just a few women, amen? People came from different backgrounds. They came from different families. They came from different nationalities. But you know what? They had the same dream. They wanted to become a nurse. And in this mixed all those different personalities, some strong, some complacent, some giving, some getting. And it became a dog-eat-dog place because people were wanting the raises, they were wanting the certain shifts, they were wanting the better places. You understand how that goes. But now let me tell you how we can live in that volatile place. Jesus tells his disciples to follow him and to be salt of the world. And how are we salt of the world? In this world, in the universal church. What about in our denomination? What about in the United States? What about in this church right here, Hope GMV? How do we become salt? How do we use the salt God gave us? We stick to the purpose. And do you know what the purpose is? To love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. That's what God wants from us. Listen to this phrase from Joan Chittister. She says, when I set my heart on one thing and one thing only, one way, my way, I doom myself to a crippled life in a cage far too small for my heart to grow. I wonder, have we actually placed ourselves in a cage that is too small for our heart to grow? When it becomes my way or the highway, the cage is too small. If I was to go out in Gardendale and say, what does that church up there on the hill, the one with the chimes that chimes every hour, what do they do? What do they stand for? What do you think they would say? I dare not think they would say that God is our main purpose and loving our neighbor is second. But you see, that's the purpose that God has for us. How do we start doing that? Say we come in and we feel like we've lost our saltiness. How do we get that back? This morning's worship was very, very poignant. Very. When we come to worship, when we come to church on Sunday morning, it's not because it says in here, thou shalt worship at 9:30 on Sunday morning, or another place, thou shalt worship at 11 o'clock on Sunday morning. Doesn't say that. It says worship. It is not something that we click off of our box and say, yep, been to church today. Coming to church is not so you can learn something new in worship. Sunday school, another story. But when you come to worship, you come to worship that audience of one. An audience of one. Let me tell you, I worship mostly in 11 o'clock and we sing the hymns and I love the hymns. And those who sit around me know I need singing lessons because I love to sing, but I can't sing. But I will belt out those hymns because I am worshiping an audience of one. I'll close my eyes, I'll stand there, and I will just be in God's presence. Don't you know God loves it? He doesn't care whether his choir is on or off key. Now, Jenny's choir may be a different story. They need to be on. The praise band, y'all are a different story. But us, we get to worship with all we have. Because we are worshiping an audience of one. And no, you don't come to church for the sermon. Now, you may get a nudging that's from God that says, you might need to listen to this. I may say something that all of a sudden hits you upside the head and you think, where did that come from? That's God speaking to you. You're not coming here to listen to what Judy Shepherd has to say or what Steve Backus has to say. You're coming to worship the Lord, and you're coming to hear the message and what God has for you to say today. We need to find a place to worship God with all that we have. You know, one of the things that is so important is praying. When I was offered this job, my gut reaction was, no, I don't want to come back. But I said I'd pray about it. And I got me some prayer warriors. And I said, I want you to pray for discernment for me, please. And what they came back with was, keep your boundaries, Judy. You can't work 80 hours a week. But this is going to be a good thing for you and what your purpose in life is. You see, I love to connect people to God. I love to see people come worship together and worship a holy God. I love for people to find a place to love God and love others. Now, for me, I teach Sunday school every other month. I'm a backup to Mark Ford, who teaches Coffee in Christ, which starts September 7th, for those of you in here. September 7th, Coffee in Christ starts. Lunch Bunch after that. Little plug there. Game day starts Thursday. Is this Thursday come? Bring a dish and a game. It'll be fun. I also will attend Coffee in Christ. I will attend Lunch Bunch. I have attended Game Day. I am in a prayer bead ministry. There's one, and I don't know if they'll stay. And here's the other. I made these last night while I was going over this. It's not going to stay. This is not my job. This is what I do because I love the Lord and I love people. And that's what God is wanting me to do. I want to love God with all that I am, all that I have, and all that I can possibly do for Him. And I want people to join me. I want people to come along with me. Let's love God together. Do you know what? If we all loved people, I dare say there'd be peace in the world. I promise you. I promise you, we would have peace. You go over to these foreign countries where we're in war, and you know, I'm not a history buff or a geography buff or a news buff, so I don't know all that stuff, but I'm telling you, you go over there, and if we could sit down and listen to what each other is saying and not assume that we have the right answer, if we could love people as God loves people, I dare say we would see peace. Hey, we may see Jesus come back too. Wouldn't it be wonderful? Okay, so let's go back to the purpose of the sermon. Salt. Are you salt? Your challenge this week is to go home and sit with the purpose, which is to love God and love people. How do you do it? How are you loving God? How are you loving people? Is God calling you salt and that you're good? Or does he want to throw you out? And even the soil and the manure pile are not good enough. Let's be salty Christians on a mission in cahoots with God. Amen and amen. Pray with me, please. Lord, you are an awesome Holy One, Holy Three, and we love you, Lord. Help us, Lord, to love you with our whole heart, with our mind, with our strength, with our will. And God, those people that we don't like, let us look at them and see that we are indeed looking at Christ in skin. Because, Lord, you are in them as well. We don't have all the answers, Lord. We know that. So guide us, direct us, and help us be salty Christians. It's in the name of Christ we pray. Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, armed through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Jesus commands my destiny.
Amen. So, are we salty Christians? Amen. Amen. Go in the love of God and the power of the Holy Spirit and the very presence of Jesus with you. Amen. Amen. And amen. Please remember to exit out. Yes, we're a little late. Out the doors. Thank you.